Good evening, everyone. My name is Greg Gorga. I want to welcome you here to the Santa Barbara Maritime Museum. I'm the executive director here. Anybody first time here at the Maritime Museum? Andy. Yeah. Oh, boy. All right. Well, welcome, and the rest of you, welcome back to the Santa Barbara Maritime Museum. So I am very excited, as I'm sure you are, to hear tonight's lecture. Chet Van Duzer studied mathematics, English literature, Latin, and ancient Greek at UC Berkeley, but it was some years before he came to study old maps. He was drawn to the subject at a very specific moment. In 1997, he was at the Vatican Museums and saw a manuscript of Ptolemy's geography on display. The manuscript was open to a world map that had been painted in about 1530. That map had some unusual features that he set about investigating, and he has been hooked on old maps ever since. I'm going to butcher some of the Latin that comes up in the next paragraph. I only know two languages, and one is Jersey slang, and I barely know English. Chet is an invited research scholar at the John Carter Brown Library in Providence, Rhode Island, and will return to the Library of Congress to work on special projects in the Geography and Map Division this spring. He has published extensively on medieval and Renaissance maps in journals such as Imago Mundi, Terra Incognita, and World and Image. He's also the author of Johann Schoner's Globe of 1515, Transcription and Study, which is the first detailed analysis of one of the earliest surviving terrestrial globes. That includes the New World. I just love to see some of these things. And he, along with John Hessler, authored Seeing the World Anew, The Radical Vision of Martin Waldseemüller's 1507 and 1516 world maps. His book, Sea Monsters, on Medieval and Renaissance Maps, which will be available for sale after the lecture, and he'll, I'm sure, autograph those for you. This book was published last year by the British Library, and this year the Library of Congress will publish a study of Christopher Columbus's Book of Privileges, which he co-authored with John Hessler and Daniel DeSimone. His current book project is the commentary for a facsimile of the 1550 manuscript world map by Pierre de Solares, which will be published by the British Library. Please join me in welcoming Chet Van Duzer.
Well, thank you all for coming, and I want to begin by thanking the Santa Barbara Maritime Museum for having me here today. My subject this evening is a fun one, Sea Monsters on Medieval and Renaissance Maps. The sea monsters on these maps are one of their most lively and visually engaging elements, and they inform an important chapter in the history of the scientific illustration of animals and in the history of art. Further, as we will see, they can provide interesting information about the sources that cartographers used in creating their maps. Yet strangely, they have received very little study. In what follows, we will look at images of sea monsters on maps from the 10th century until the early 17th century. But we will begin with some preliminary matters, some thoughts on the definition of sea monster, a brief look at a classical, medieval, and Renaissance theory that generated many sea monsters, a review of an ancient story about whales that is illustrated on several of the maps we will see, and a look at the different types of medieval maps. So let me just sort out the remote control here. There we go. What is a sea monster? Let's look at a couple classic examples here just to get started. What is a sea monster? The word monster is notoriously difficult to define. And indeed, some of the definitions of monster offered by medieval authors are contradictory. While many authors, both classical and medieval, define a monster as being in some way against nature, for St. Augustine and Isidore of Seville, a monster is part of God's plan, an adornment of the universe that can also teach about the dangers of sin. The 13th century writer and theologian Thomas of Cantempre, in his encyclopedia titled On the Nature of Things, singles out rarity and large size as two of the distinguishing characteristics of sea monsters, but I think we would all agree that some creatures that we would classify as monsters are not necessarily large. For purposes of this talk, a sea monster will be defined as an aquatic creature that was thought astonishing and exotic, regardless of whether it was real or mythical, in classical, medieval, or Renaissance times. I also want to emphasize how the idea of what a monster is has changed over time. Today, when we see a picture of a whale, for example, we see a mighty and intelligent mammal that is to be protected. And the same is true of walruses. Yet these creatures were considered monsters in the Middle Ages and Renaissance. And we see here a map from 1595 on which a walrus is explicitly called a monster. It's interesting to think about how our definitions of what is monstrous might change in the future. I want to talk about a theory of correspondence between land and sea creatures that was generated a large number of sea monsters. A number of the monsters that we will see on medieval maps are hybrids, such as the aquatic lion we see here. And the source of many of these creatures was the ancient and medieval theory that every land creature had its equivalent in the sea. This theory, which is mentioned by Pliny the Elder, Isidore of Seville, and Gervase of Tilbury, for example, is illustrated in a number of Roman mosaics, as well as on the maps we'll be seeing. So we see here a Roman mosaic of an aquatic goat, and even an aquatic eagle. So every creature on land has its equivalent in the sea, and that generated many different sea monsters. And I want to talk about a story about whales that is illustrated on a number of maps we'll see. A widespread ancient and medieval story about whales is that of sailors mistaking a whale for an island. This story first appears in the Physiologus, which was written in the 3rd century AD. This book consists of brief stories about animals, birds, fantastic creatures, and some stones and plants, each provided with a moral interpretation. The chapter about the whale says that the whale has the appearance of an island, and sailors fix stakes on the supposed island, tie their ship, descend upon the island, and light fires to cook food. When the whale feels the burning of the fire, it plunges into the depths of the sea and carries with it ships and all. The moral is that if one puts one's faith in the devil, one shall be carried by him to the depths of hell. Variants of the story are illustrated in medieval bestiaries, as we see in this image. In this image, the whale is very fish-like, but other illustrations of the same scene show different conceptions of the whale. So in this illustration, we can see there are plants growing on the whale's back, and that's part of the reason that the sailors mistook it for an island. Here again, we have the plants growing on the whale's back. This is a very dramatic scene. The boat doesn't look very stable. And this image really brings out the size of the whale, so very different from the first image in which the whale was basically a sizable fish. And I want to point out the sort of beard of the whale here. We'll be coming back to that a bit later. And the story of the whale mistaken for an island also appears in the life of St. Brendan, a medieval Irish saint who was said to have gone on a long voyage in the Atlantic, during which he landed on several islands. And since we don't see a medieval map every day, I'm going to also introduce this talk by having a quick look at the different types of medieval maps. And there are three basic types: mappae mundi, or world maps; nautical charts, which were practical instruments of navigation and are perhaps more familiar to this audience; and manuscripts of Ptolemy's geography. So the first type is mappae mundi. I'm just going to go through these pretty quickly, and it's a very brief introduction. So this is a modern map of the world, very recognizable. I'm going to crop it down to the area depicted on medieval mappae mundi. I'm then going to rotate it to put east at the top, which was the orientation used on most medieval mappae mundi. And then I'm going to put it next to a medieval mappae mundi. So as you can see, this map is very schematic. It's not going to help you get anywhere. It's an educational device. It tells you the relative locations and very approximate relative sizes of the three continents. And this type of map was known as a TO map, and that comes from its structure. And I'm gonna point out that this manuscript, a 15th century manuscript, is calling the map a TO map, so that name goes back a long way. And here we see why it's called a TO map. The O is the circumfluent ocean that surrounds the world. And the T consists of the bodies of water that separate Europe, Asia, and Africa. So we have the Tanais River, or the Don River, separating Asia from Europe, the Nile separating Asia from Africa, and the Mediterranean separating Europe from Africa. And of course, what I just showed you is a very simple, very schematic mapamundi. There are more elaborate examples like this one. And it is precisely the more elaborate and larger examples that are likely to have more illustrations and thus are likely to include sea monsters. And so looking at a larger example here, this is from the 10th century. We'll come back to this one later, but this one is large enough and detailed enough that there are sea monsters in the circumfluent ocean. And just briefly point out one other type of medieval mapamundi, which has the same circular format, but is based on a different conception. The idea is that there are climatic zones in the world. So the equator is unlivably hot, something that we might be thinking about today. To the north and south of the equator are temperate zones that are habitable, and then to the north and south of those are frigid zones that are so cold that they're uninhabitable. And we'll be seeing one example of this type of map later that does involve sea monsters. And now we'll have a quick look at nautical charts, which were very different. They were a practical tool for navigation, very different from the mapamundi we just looked at. This is the area depicted on a typical medieval nautical chart. It's the Mediterranean basin, including some of the Atlantic, east to the Holy Land, and including North Africa. And now I'm going to switch to a nautical chart that shows that same area. It's a chart from 1489. It takes a moment to orient yourself when you see a chart like this. The Red Sea in the lower right-hand corner is very helpfully painted red. I've indicated Spain there, and the green, large green thing in North Africa is the Atlas Mountains. And you can see the familiar shape of Italy right in the middle of the map is also quite helpful. So I'm going to zoom in on Spain here. And this map is quite heavily decorated. The essence of medieval nautical chart are, you can see the place names written all along the coast, and they're written perpendicular to the coast, and the more important ones are in red. So the emphasis is on coastal features. And then you'll see this network of lines radiating across the chart. Those are called rum lines. And those are the two characteristic features, the basic sort of skeleton of a nautical chart. The interior on this chart is heavily decorated with images of cities, flags indicating political control. And it's more heavily decorated examples that are likely to include sea monsters. Have a quick look at Italy on the same chart. You can see these large depictions of Genoa and Venice, and that strange shaped thing just to the left of Genoa is the Alps. And here we have a very basic nautical chart. So this is closer to a nautical chart that might have been taken to sea. The elaborately decorated ones were more for collection by nobles, display, and education. This is at least closer to something that might be taken to sea. It doesn't have the expensive artistic decorations. The emphasis is on coastal features, and again, this the network of rum lines. And then we'll look quickly at the third type of medieval maps, the maps and manuscripts of Ptolemy's geography. Here is the world map in a 15th century manuscript of Ptolemy. Again, it takes a moment to orient oneself. Particularly because the map shows a feature that doesn't exist, so it's very unfamiliar to our eyes, which is that land bridge joining southern Africa to southern Asia. If that existed, it would be impossible to sail around Africa to reach the Indian Ocean from Europe, but Ptolemy believed that existed. I've indicated the Mediterranean, the Indian Ocean on the right with the island of Taprobana, which corresponds to modern Sri Lanka. And I want to point out that I'm looking at Spain here to emphasize the difference with the nautical chart image we just saw. Here, the interior is dense with detail, dense with names of cities, mountain ranges. There's not the same emphasis on coastal features at all. And also in the margins, I want to point out the scales of latitude and longitude. So Ptolemy organized space by latitude and longitude, which to us seems very natural. But when Ptolemy was rediscovered in the 14th and 15th century, it was very revolutionary. And again, just for contrast, I'll show the image of Italy in the same manuscript.
The green things are mountains.
The green things are mountains, yes. And we'll move on to sea monsters now, at long last. So I'll start with the same 10th century map that we saw earlier. Most medieval mappi mundi, like the ones I showed at the start, are small and schematic and do not have sea monsters, but there is a group of larger and much more elaborate world maps produced from the 10th to the 13th century that do include illustrations of sea creatures and sea monsters. These are the mappa mundi illustrating manuscripts of the Commentary on the Apocalypse by Beatus of Liébana, who lived in the 8th to 9th century. So we'll zoom in on this map, and we can see here a marine chicken. So this is precisely one of the hybrid creatures that I mentioned earlier in the talk. And then here, it's a little difficult to make out, but we have a man who's inside a sea monster. And this is almost certainly Jonah, and this is confirmed, I think, by his gesture. He's holding his hand to his mouth, no doubt to indicate that he's praying for deliverance. Usually, Jonah is represented either being swallowed by the sea monster or emerging from it, and we can see both of those depicted on this pulpit in Ravello. Zoomed in a little bit here to see him emerging. And here he is emerging from the sea monster, and in this case the creature is rather more whale-like. You can see there's a blowhole on the top of his head. So images of Jonah being inside the sea monster are actually quite rare, but I was able to find one other example in a 9th century Psalter. And I think this corroborates the identification of that man inside the sea monster as Jonah. This is another world map in a manuscript of the Commentary on the Apocalypse by Beatus of Liébana. This manuscript is in San Andrés de Arroyo in Spain. I'm going to zoom in here a little bit and look at this siren. The siren is making what I would call a dancing gesture. And I think the implication is that she's singing, because that's what classical sirens did. They sang to sailors and enticed them out of their ships onto their island. And zooming in on the western part of the map, we see here a sea dragon to the left. In the middle, we have a man represented wrestling two sea serpents, and that's a personification of ocean. And then on the right, we have a starfish. And the location of the starfish on this map is interesting because it accords perfectly with the location ascribed to the creature by the medieval encyclopedist Thomas of Cantempre, who says that the starfish lives in the Western Ocean, and that's precisely the part of the map we're seeing here. The map was made in the 13th century, after the year 1248, which is not long after Thomas of Cantempre had finished his book. So it seems likely that the location of the starfish in the Western Ocean represents the influence of that book. So we have here an example of a cartographer making use of the latest information about sea monsters that was available to him in the creation of his map. And the starfish looks rather fantastic, but he was using a source that he thought was reliable and that had been produced quite recently. So he was doing his best to portray a real sea creature. This is the manuscript of that same work, which is in Manchester. And in this case, it's quite difficult to see the creatures. It's black ink on a dark blue background. But we have a remarkable group of sea monsters in the southeastern part of the circumfluent ocean, that is in the part most distant from Europe, where people might think that anything was possible. We have a large siren grabbing a sea serpent with her hand, while a fish nibbles at her tail, and a long sea serpent with a feline head is eating the fish, which is nibbling on the siren. While chains of creatures biting each other are not uncommon in medieval art, there is no similar group of sea monsters on any other map in these Beatus manuscripts, or indeed in any other medieval map that I've seen. This group of sea monsters thus shows that the artist who made this map was felt free to innovate, rather than just copying an earlier map in this group. The map also clearly indicates the savagery of the outer ocean and its monsters. Moving on now from Beatus Mappae Mundi. This Mappae Mundi is in a manuscript of the year more or less 1180. And it presents a striking vision of the circular disk of the Earth divided into climatic zones with cold at the poles and hot at the equator, surrounded by an enormous serpentine monster, which is devouring its own tail. And beyond it in the ocean, there are four hybrid monsters with human heads and fishy bodies and tails. The monster encircling the world is intended to represent the biblical Leviathan in the outer ocean. On this Mappae Mundi, the sea monsters not only encircle and thus contain the Earth, but also dominate the image visually. The details of the Earth's climatic zones seem insignificant compared to the presence of these enormous monsters. Just to zoom in there and see the detail a bit.
So East is still at the top there?
As it happens in this one, yes, East is still at the top. This is the Church of St. Martin in Zillis, Switzerland, which dates to the mid-12th century, and it has a ceiling consisting of 153 painted panels depicting scenes from the Bible and from the life of St. Martin. Zoom in a bit here. In each of the four corners of the ceiling, there's an angel holding two trumpets, clearly inspired by St. John's vision of four angels standing at the four corners of the earth in Revelation 7:1. Further, the water depicted along the four edges of the composition is clearly intended to represent the circumfluent ocean, so that the ceiling, although not a map in the modern sense of the word, is an image of the world as a stage for the playing out of Christian history. The ocean surrounding the earth in the ceiling at Zillis abounds with sea monsters, including a particularly large number of hybrid creatures. So we have here a sea stag being bitten by a sea lion, perhaps, it's hard to be sure. A aquatic lion, I'm a little bit more confident about that identification, eating a marine chicken. We can see the long fishy tail there. And a sea elephant, which is, I'm quite confident, intended to represent a walrus. Here the monsters clearly indicate that the edges of the world are full of chaotic wonders and dangers, and they may also allude to the diversity and fullness of God's creation. Moving on to sea monsters on nautical charts now. This is a nautical chart from 1367 by the Pizzigani brothers of Italy, and I've indicated the areas of interest there and tried to give us a little orientation. So that's Spain at the lower part of the map. So we're out in the Atlantic here. And zooming in, we have a giant octopus attacking a ship and a flying dragon carrying away one of the sailors. A legend nearby explains that while these ships were going to port, dragons and octopuses came and carried away men from the ships and bore them into the sea and left the ships empty. I've not been able to determine the source of the story of the flying dragons, but we can identify the likely source of the octopuses attacking the ships. Thomas of Cantempre, in his encyclopedia titled On the Nature of Things, says that the arms of the octopus are so strong that they can pull a mariner from a ship into the sea and then eat him. And we have an illustration here from a manuscript of that work. Thus, the Pizzagani brothers took some of their information about sea monsters from, directly or indirectly, from what they considered a scientific source, this Encyclopedia of Thomas of Cantempre, which was completed about 100 years before they made this map. The information about and images of sea monsters on the Pizzagani map vividly illustrate the perceived dangers of navigation in the Atlantic. I mean, who wants to go where you can be attacked by giant octopuses and flying dragons? And this is the Catalan Atlas made in Mallorca in about 1375. It is one of the most elaborately decorated nautical charts that survives. I'm going to zoom in a bit on the lower right there. We see there's a siren in the Indian Ocean. And this distant and exotic ocean was a common venue for sea monsters on maps. Again, it was one of the farthest places on the earth of which Europeans had any knowledge, and they tended to ascribe various marvels and wonders to that ocean. In the Persian Gulf, we have two naked men in the water gathering what seemed to be colored rocks, and two well-toothed sea monsters are swimming away from them. A legend to the northwest explains that these men are pearl divers and says that they use magic spells to keep the sea monsters away. If they do not say the spells, the sea monsters will eat them. This represents an unusual case in which humans have some control over and protection from sea monsters. Here we have the nautical chart by Mathieu de Villadestes, made in 1413. It has a whaling scene, which you can see in the upper left, in the North Atlantic. This is the earliest I know of on any map. I'm going to zoom in here. You can see the position of the whale relative to the British Isles, and then zooming in more. In this detail, we see that the ship has fixed its anchor in the whale, and there are two men in a small boat near the whale, but they did not seem to be taking any action in relation to the whale. The long legend below the scene falls naturally into two parts, as I indicate in this slide. The sea is called Ocean Sea, and therein are found great fish, which sailors take to be small islands, and take up their quarters on these fish, and the sailors land on these islands and make fires, and cause such heat that the fish feels it and sets itself in motion, and they have no time to get on board and are lost. So again, this is the story of sailors mistaking a whale for an island. But then the second part is very different. And those who know this land on the said fish and there make thongs of its back and make fast the head of the ship's anchor. And in this way, they flay the skin off it, whereof they make ropes for the ships. And of this skin are made good coverings for haystacks. Thus, the first part of the legend recounts the myth of the whale mistaken for an island, while the second part conveys very practical information about what use can be made of the whale's skin. This combination of myth and practical information suggests that the cartographer was combining material from different sources without having any firsthand experience with whales whatsoever. This is the so-called Genoese map of 1457, and it has four prominent sea monsters in the Indian Ocean, which again is a common venue for the depiction of exotic creatures. So I highlighted them here, and now we'll look at them one by one. One of these creatures is a composite sea hog, so a pig with a fish's tail, located off the eastern coast of Africa. We also have a siren, and a fish with a human face and a large spiky red crest on its head. The legend explains that this is a sera, as in serration. This monster is said to attack the ships of India, usually breaking them immediately, but its crest can get stuck in the ship's wood, and as a result, the creature, unable to escape, kills itself. In the eastern Indian Ocean, there is an imposing creature with a humanoid head and upper body, but with large horns and ears and wing-like red membranes joining its outstretched arms to its torso and a fish-like tail. The legend says that this creature sprang out of the water and attacked some cows pasturing on the shore, and then was captured and mounted and exhibited in Venice and elsewhere. The ultimate source of this monster was a book by the Italian writer Poggio Bracciolini, written between 1438 and 1452, which describes a similar monster that attacked women by the seashore and was killed and exhibited in Ferrara. Here we see an illustration of that monster, which is clearly very similar to that on the map. This is another case in which, although the monster seems like something that the cartographer invented, in fact he took it from a book that he thought was accurate. The cartographer was depicting what he thought was real. This is the Catalan Estense map of about 1460. It's unusual because its anonymous cartographer has used the rum line system and emphasis on coastal features of nautical charts, but placed that data in the circular format of a mappa mundi, so he's combining two genres here. In the Indian Ocean there, which I've highlighted, we see three sirens. One is half woman, half fish, one is half woman, half bird, and one is half woman, half horse, as the accompanying legend describes. The half woman, half fish holds a mirror, symbolically indicating beauty, but also vanity. And this map reveals an interesting aspect of the painting of sea monsters on maps. If we look closely, we can see a faint rectangular border around each of the sirens, and it is clear that the first artist left a blank space in the pattern of the waves, which was filled in by the second artist, a sea monster specialist. A Latin manuscript of Ptolemy's Geography, which was made in Florence in about 1455 to 60, contains a truly remarkable number and variety of sea monsters. In fact, the richest collection of sea monsters I've seen in any manuscript. These monsters are noteworthy because no sea monsters appear in any of the other 53 surviving manuscripts of Ptolemy's Geography that possess maps. So here I've shown some of the sea monsters in this manuscript. We can see there's a particular type of siren in the upper right there. Here we have two types of sirens on the same map, one in the upper register and the other in the lower right. So the one in the lower right has two tails and is clothed. And here the upper part we have what seems to be an aquatic rabbit, or and then at the bottom another aquatic pig. So more of the hybrid sea creatures I talked about at the beginning, resulting from that theory that every land creature had a corresponding sea creature. The great number of sea monsters on these maps suggests that they were part of the original commission for the manuscript. That is, the sea monsters were an extra cost option chosen for inclusion by the person who was paying for the creation of the manuscript. This is Piri Reis's map of 1513. Piri Reis was a Turkish sea captain and cartographer who lived from about 1470 to about 1555. In a text on this map, he says that he made it by combining information from 20 different maps, including medieval mappae mundi, Arabic maps, Portuguese nautical charts, and a map by Christopher Columbus, no less. Here's a detail of the scene with a whale, which is another illustration of the story of a whale mistaken for an island. The legend confirms that in this case, the image illustrates specifically the story of St. Brendan. The legend runs, "It is said that in ancient times, a priest by the name of St. Brendan sailed through the seven seas. He is said to have landed on this fish, thought it was dry land, and lit a fire on this fish. When the back of the fish began to burn, it plunged into the sea. The people re-embarked in their boats and fled to the ship. This event is not reported by the Portuguese infidels. It is taken from the ancient mappa mundi." The image on Piri Reis's map is the earliest surviving representation of the story of St. Brendan and the whale on a map, although the fact that the cartographer says that he was using information from other maps suggests that he borrowed this image from an earlier map. So there were no doubt earlier images of the story on maps, but we don't have them. This is the earliest surviving one. I want to talk now about the sea monsters of the Renaissance, and particularly the transition from medieval sea monsters on maps to Renaissance monsters. The transition from sea monsters of the Middle Ages to those of the Renaissance can be seen with remarkable clarity in two important maps by the same cartographer, which are on permanent display in the Library of Congress. This is Martin Waldseemüller's world map of 1507, which is the earliest to apply the name America to the New World. It does not include any images of sea monsters, but it does have several texts about sea monsters in the Indian Ocean. The texts come from medieval sources and quite naturally describe the monsters as dangerous so that they would be understood as hazards to navigation. This is the same cartographer, Martin Waldseemüller's Carta Marina of 1516, produced just 9 years later. On this map, Waldseemüller has abandoned the medieval texts about sea monsters from his 1507 map, but illustrates one sea monster off the southern coast, southern tip of Africa. I'm going to zoom in here. And this is an image of King Manuel of Portugal riding a sea monster. And in an artistic terms, this is the first truly Renaissance image of a sea monster on a map. The monster is drawn in three dimensions and is shown as being in motion in contrast to most medieval sea monsters. But this is also a Renaissance image in another sense. While the sea monsters on Waldseemüller's earlier map are dangerous and thus would discourage navigation, the image on the Carta Marina shows a human controlling a sea monster and thus boldly proclaims human mastery over the dangers of the sea and by extension, dominion over the oceans themselves. The ocean is thus no longer a place of danger, so much as an element that can be conquered by humans and across which trade can be conducted. These two maps and their sea monsters, made just 9 years apart, reflect a transition from a medieval to a Renaissance conception of the ocean. Olaus Magnus was a Swedish historian and geographer who lived from 1490 to 1557. In 1539, he published this map of Scandinavia, the Norwegian Sea, and the North Sea, titled Carta Marina. And in 1555, he published a book titled History of the Northern Peoples that supplies more detail about some of the sea monsters depicted on this map. I'm zooming in a little bit there. As we can see, the map is full of sea monsters. The Norwegian Sea is very densely populated with a variety of sea creatures and sea monsters. The images on this map are quite original, and they were by far the most influential sea monsters on maps of the 16th century. We'll see evidence of their influence shortly. So let's have a look at a few of the monsters here. In his book, Olaus Magnus explains of this one that it's called the Spouter, or Leviathan, and it's 300 feet long. In order to destroy sailors, it often rises above the yardarms of vessels and spurts forth the waves it has sucked into the tubes above its head. And then another image of the same creature, and he goes on to say, sometimes it is not satisfied with doing mischief to a ship merely by showering water on it. It throws itself onto a ship's prow or stern and presses on it till the vessel sinks down and becomes submerged, or fiercely overturns it with its back or tail, as if the craft were some small dish. Another image here. We have, in this image, an illustration of a method for scaring away attacking sea monsters. So practical information might be good to keep in mind. In his book, Olaus Magnus says, voyagers to India confirm the enormous size of these brutes and say that the sound of shouting and trumpets repels and disperses them. So the fellow on the stern of the ship there, that's not a gun, but a trumpet that he's using to scare the sea monster away. This creature called the Xiphias, which is eating a seal at the same time it's being bitten by another sea monster, Olaus Magnus explains, the Xiphias has a ghastly head like that of an owl. Its back, a back that is tapering, or rather raised into the form of a sword, and a sharply pointed beak. And an absolutely classic image that I showed right at the beginning here. Olaus Magnus says, a serpent of gigantic bulk, at least 200 feet long and 20 feet thick, frequents the cliffs and hollows of the seacoast near Bergen. It assaults ships, rearing itself on high like a pillar, seizes men, and devours them. And it's very difficult to see, but the sea monster actually has a sailor in its mouth there. A colleague of mine, Luigi Diana, has given an interesting explanation of the many sea monsters in the Norwegian Sea on Olaus Magnus's map. He suggests that they were intended to scare away fishermen of other nations, leaving the abundant catch to Scandinavian fishermen. If this suggestion is correct, it represents a unique use of sea monsters on maps for economic motives. Just a quick look at the Northern Sea on that map again. This is Gerard Mercator's globe of 1541, which was one of the most important and influential of the 16th century. For the sea monsters on his globe, Mercator made use of Olaus Magnus's map, which had been published just 2 years earlier. So here's the whale on Mercator's globe, and here's the whales from the whale from Olaus Magnus's map, again published just 2 years earlier. And here's another whale on Mercator's globe, and another of the whales on Olaus Magnus's map. So in this case, Mercator has removed the ship, but in other respects, the creatures are very similar.
The same monster
specialist. That's right. This globe thus not only provides evidence of the influence of Olaus Magnus's map, but also shows Mercator's interest in using the most recent sources available to him for the sea monsters on his maps and globes. This is a large world map hand-painted by Pierre Dessalier in 1546. The map contains a diverse collection of sea monsters, including the first realistic whaling seen on any map, the first sawfish on a map, and also a sea dragon that seems based on medieval imagery. In the North Atlantic between Newfoundland and Labrador, five men in a small boat are harpooning a whale. We are no doubt to understand that they came from the ship nearby. To judge from their clothes, and I'm going to zoom in a little bit more here, the men in the boat are most likely Basque, and the Basque tradition of whaling goes back to the 11th century. The whale has two harpoons sticking from its back, and quite curiously seems to have wings, and also what looks like a large mustache. The mustache is no doubt the cartographer's attempt to portray baleen, which the Basques commonly refer to as barbas de ballena, or beards of the whale. And I'll hark back at this moment to the large whale I showed earlier that had these whiskers on its face. Although this whaling scene has some fanciful elements, even the mustache represents an interest in making the depiction of the whale as accurate as possible. And the whaling scene is much more realistic than the scene on Mathieu de Villadeste's map of 1413, which we saw earlier. Here we see the sawfish off the eastern coast of South America. I'm going to zoom in a little bit more. Given its location, it seems likely that the cartographer's source was either a description of the creature in the 1535 edition of Gonzalo Fernandez de Oviedo's General History of the New World, in which the creature is presented as a great novelty, or else an illustrated manuscript of Oviedo's book, for there is one surviving manuscript of the work that has an illustration of a sawfish, which we see here. Going back to this map from 1546, west of Java Minor, that is in the Indian Ocean, we have a beautiful sea dragon. I'm zooming in a bit more here, which is quite similar to some medieval depictions of the creature that swallowed Jonah. Given the variety of sea monsters on this map, so both some of the most recent sea monsters that had been discussed in the literature and this more medieval image, it seems likely that the cartographer had a strong interest in this subject and had collected examples for his map from many sources. We have here an image of Gerard Mercator's famous world map of 1569, whose title translates as New and Improved Description of the World for the Use of Navigators. And most people have heard the name Mercator, the Mercator projection. That comes from this map. That's what this map is best known for. It's the first to implement Mercator's projection, The projection is advantageous because it allows a map, on a map made with it, a course of compass, constant compass bearing is represented by a straight line. The sea monsters on this map, which have never been really examined in detail, reveal one of the sources that Mercator was using. They come from a book about sea creatures by Pierre Bellon that was published 16 years before the map. So if we zoom in a bit on the image of the whale and look at the whale in Bellon's book, we can see that the one on the map was clearly copied from the book. Similarly, there's a sea serpent in the South Atlantic. And if we compare it with Bellon's book, again, there can be really little doubt of the source he was using. And to take one more example, Neptune riding a seahorse, and Mercator has added Neptune, but the seahorse is very, very similar. On Mercator's globe of 1541, which we saw earlier, he borrowed his whales from Olaus Magnus's map, which was published 2 years before his globe. And on his 1569 map, which we're looking at now, he copied his sea monsters from Pierre Bellon's book, which was published 16 years earlier. In both cases, he made use of the most recent works about sea creatures that were available to him. Again, rather than the cartographers just inventing sea monsters, they were trying their best to use the most recent information available to them. On the other hand, there certainly are sea monsters on maps that are purely whimsical. And that became a bit of a fashion in the second half of the 16th century. There was a fashion for whimsical sea monsters on maps. And this fashion represents a shift in the role of cartographic sea monsters from being indications of the dangers of the ocean, which also served a decorative purpose, to being more purely decorative. Many of these sea monsters are the result of combining the parts of different creatures, a common technique used in the creation of monsters, while others seem to be the products, purely the products of the cartographer's imagination or whimsy. So if we look at this one, I mean, it's some of them are so fantastic that it's really hard to describe them at all. My guess on this one is an aquatic pig dog. A huge humanoid sea monster just getting ready to attack a ship. Early windsurfing.
That's
right. And this extravagant composite monster is based on a whale because it's spouting, but it spouts through no less than 5 elephant's trunks and has the head of a bird. If the ocean was gradually becoming less dangerous to sailors in the late 16th century, it was still a realm where exotic creations of the imagination could be projected. In 1592, Johannes van de Wettekom designed a map of Canada and the North Atlantic titled Nova Francia. From the point of view of sea monsters, the map is of interest for a striking contrast it reveals. In the Atlantic, I'm circling them here, it has some fantastic depictions of whales that derive, probably indirectly, from Olaus Magnus's map. While near the lower edge of the map, there is an inset scene that shows naked and half-naked men, possibly Basque to judge from their helmets and boats, throwing spears and harpoons into whales. We'll zoom in on that a little bit here. In fact, the realistic whaling inset is copied from a plate published in 1582. The two whales in this inset look completely different from, and are much more lifelike than, the whale-like creatures in the Atlantic, which we see here. So we can compare and contrast the fantastic whale-like creatures above with the more realistic ones in the inset. So this map uses two different iconographical traditions of whales, one older and essentially mythical, the other more modern and realistic. In 1621, Honorius Philoponus published an account of the Benedictine missionaries who accompanied Christopher Columbus on his second voyage to the Americas. The book is part history and part fantasy and contains curious illustrations, including this map of the North Atlantic. We see here again a representation of St. Brendan mistaking a whale for an island, and in this case, his men are celebrating mass on the whale's back. The whale is clearly inspired by those on Olaus Magnus's map, and thus, in the 17th century, not only Olaus Magnus' sea monsters, but also the myth of St. Brendan still had a hold on people's imagination. Yet the age of sea monsters on maps was beginning to come to an end. Just 4 years after the map I just showed, a very different and much more pragmatic and realistic map with images of whales was published. This is Thomas Edge's map of Greenland, by which he actually means Spitsbergen. This confusion of names was common in the 17th century. The map was made in 1625 and has vignettes of the Arctic whale fishery around it. Start looking at those here. Although the images are of a very simple artistic style, they're remarkable as they illustrate all the methods involved in catching and processing a whale, so that the map shows the captain of a whaling ship both where to go and the fundamental steps of how to do his job. So here we have flensing the whale, landing and cutting up the blubber, boiling, filtering, and barreling the blubber, cleaning and scraping the whale fins, as they're called above, that is the baleen. And I'll just mention that baleen was used in corsets, hoop skirts, umbrellas, and buggy whips. We have seen depictions of whaling on earlier maps, but I would suggest that in this map, Thomas Edge shows the whale in a very different light. Here, the mighty Leviathan is perceived as an object of economic exploitation and has lost much of its monstrosity. The different images of whales on De Wedekind's map of 1592, some fantastic and others realistic, together with the contrasting images of whales on Philoponus's 1621 map and Thomas Edge's map, clearly show that the late 16th and early 17th centuries were a time of transition for sea monsters on maps. As the 17th century progressed and navigational technology improved, sea monsters became less and less common on maps, and this chapter of the history of the illustration of sea creatures gradually closed. But rather than end on that sad note, I'll finish with images of three of my favorite sea monsters, three of the aquatic marvels that appeared on maps during the centuries that cartographic sea monsters held sway. The first is this potent image of the danger of the sea from the ceiling of the church at Zillis, Switzerland. This composite monster with the head of a dog, the torso of a man, and the tail of a fish demonstrates total control of his poor human victim. The second is another composite creature, this one of pure whimsy. In a book of maps from 1572, it has the head of an elephant and the body of a bird, but with impressive spikes jutting up from its back. And the third shows a huge sea monster preparing to bite the stern of a galley in the Mediterranean, while the sailors try to fend it off with spears. To this otherwise dire scene, a note of humor is added by the creature's enormous and elegantly curved eyelashes. Thank you very much. There are some sea monsters on maps produced in Japan, and there are also sea monsters on some Islamic maps. Those were not part of my study. I came across a few examples, but I didn't devote a lot of attention to them. Well, I devoted some personal attention to them, but they're not in the book.
Were sirens ever mermaids? They seem to look a lot alike with them.
Can you just repeat the question?
Yes, sure. The question is, were sirens ever mermaids? And that's a very good question. Trying to distinguish between sirens and mermaids is perhaps hopeless. That's a very difficult question. Yes.
Two questions. First question is, how did you possibly pick three of your favorites?
The question is, how did I pick my favorites out of these out of all of these, and it wasn't easy. This project has been a lot of fun. I mean, the research was fun, the writing was fun. So it's been a very gratifying book, and it wasn't easy at all to pick three favorites. Yes.
The artwork and these maps is amazing. Did the cartographers do the artwork and gather the information? They do all of it.
The question is whether the cartographers gathered the information and painted the sea monsters themselves. And at least in a few of the cases we looked at, we can be quite certain that it was not the cartographer who was painting the sea monsters. The one case where there was the little border around the sea monster, there was clearly a second artist had come in. There's also a case where there's a large nautical chart and there's a ship portrayed near a sea monster, and they both have water depicted beneath them. And the style, both the style in which the water is painted and the color are different. So really the only plausible explanation is that it was two different artists. So the cartographer did the cartography as such in this case, but brought in one guy to do the ships and another guy to do the sea monsters. So it was a dynamic workshop. Yes. That is a great question. Yeah, so the question is about the depiction of a southern landmass on the map from 1546. There are several other maps from that same period and that same group of cartographers who show this southern continent. And there's been a lot of ink spilled, a lot of debate about what that landmass represents. Could it be a pre-discovery of Australia? The question was, could the extension, the east-west extension of that continent be represent influence from Ptolemy's geography, there's a land bridge joining southern Asia and southern Africa? I wish I had a good answer to that question, which is a very good question. We really don't have a clear idea where that southern landmass came from. I like the question. I would be very inclined to think along those same lines, but we don't have a solid evidence to back up that suspicion.
Yes. Has your path ever crossed Nanmar? Are you familiar with the monsters in the Sea of Cortez, the giant squid?
I am not familiar. The question is, am I familiar with the sea monsters in the Sea of Cortez, the giant squid? I am not. But if you know about them and perhaps even have pictures, I would be delighted to see them. I'm sorry?
They had photographs here.
Aha, uh-huh, wonderful. Yes.
I'm curious, as I worked on giant squid, whether you see them in the Atlantic on any of the old maps?
The question is whether you see giant squid in the Atlantic on old maps. And the one image of the giant octopus attacking the ship is very unusual, actually. That in early maps, there really aren't giant squid or giant octopi attacking, depicted as sea creatures. So that's something that is surprising. We're very familiar with those images, but they do not appear on most older maps. So that one image from the map of 1367 is exceptional. Yes.
When did seafarers, people in boats, become less afraid of really something like this and they would go out without fear?
The question is, when did people become less afraid of creatures like these? And I think the argument could be made that they're not necessarily. I mean, things like Jaws, that people told me that they've been traumatized by that movie. But one interesting thing I noticed in my research is that as you move into the 17th century, depictions of sea monsters on maps decrease, but there are more depictions of ships on maps. And ships on maps sort of project this image that we can get there, we can cross the ocean, we know what this is about, whereas sea monsters on maps convey an opposite message to some extent. So that shift from sea monsters to ships, I think, indicates a greater confidence in navigating the seas. Yes.
When did they switch from east being on top? North?
The question is, when did they switch from east being maps being oriented with east on the top to maps being oriented with north on the top? And so Ptolemy's geography, north was at the top. And east is at the top on medieval Mappae Mundi, because that's where paradise was, that's where the sun rose, that was the holy direction. Ptolemy's geography was its mathematical geography. So the orientations of those works, both literally and figuratively, are very different. And the shift came when after the rediscovery of Ptolemy, people realized how useful building maps on latitude and longitude was. So that process started in the 15th century and continued into the 17th century.
Is that when the accurate maritime maps really arose, when it was a true depiction of positions of the continents, geographically?
The question is when did accurate depictions, when did maps become accurate? And so the medieval nautical charts, even from the 14th century, if you confine your attention to the Mediterranean, they're reasonably accurate. There were refinements over time. For instance, on the very earliest surviving nautical charts, Italy is a bit too wide. And over time, it became more narrow and more accurate. We do not know how that process occurred. We don't know who was gathering the data, how it was transmitted to the cartographers. But even in the earliest charts, the Mediterranean is reasonably accurate. It's when you go away from the areas that were commonly navigated that problems of accuracy arise.
And again, if you're interested in the book, Chet will be signing books over there, and you can welcome to purchase one there. Thank you very much for being here. We hope to see you back at the Maritime Museum soon. And if you're not a member, there's membership information at the front desk.